I'm very pleased to welcome Robert Lepage to Studio Q. Hello, Robert.
Hi there.
It is such a pleasure to have you here. We've talked many times, but this is the first time in Studio Q.
Absolutely, in Toronto.
We finally have you here. On Monday, you were awarded this Glenn Gould Prize at a gala celebration at Rideau Hall in Ottawa. You've collected numerous awards and honors for your work over the years. This one's a little of a different order. You were being feted for your entire body of work today.
Yeah.
How did that feel? Are you ready for a lifetime achievement?
Well, it's a bit strange. I mean, I'm 56, actually, so any lifetime achievement award feels a bit premature. But then I've been assured by a lot of people from the jury and the members of the Gould Foundation that this is actually not really about the past, that they're trying to push the idea that it's a prize that's much more about the present and the future. So I'm trying to consider it as a kind of a springboard for future work and see what... I mean, it was interesting. I don't know if you saw the Canadian Screen Awards.
Sure, when, I was there.
Yeah, that's true, you were there. Yeah, that's true. When David Cronenberg got the award and he was talking about, he was hoping there'd be an afterlife so he could get an afterlife achievement award.
Yes.
Because what do you want to do after that? But this is a bit different because, yes, it's lifetime achievement award, but it's Glenn Gould and it's associated to, the visionary work of this man and trying to walk in the footsteps of this kind of work process, if you say. So if my name is associated to the name of Glenn Gould, even for a short period of time, it's very, very prestigious.
It's awarded to an individual for a unique lifetime contribution that has enriched the human condition through the arts. That's pretty high praise in and of itself. Are you comfortable with that?
Well, no, I'm not comfortable with that at all, but
you're,
I guess I have to live with it now. No, but I'm very, very flattered by all of that. But the thing is that, it was interesting the past week, there was all these retrospectives here in Toronto at the TIFF. And I always shy away from looking back at stuff I've done. I'm not really a nostalgic person. I don't really like looking back into the past. I'm always looking forward to the next project. So this kind of forced me to watch these old films again and discuss about my old work and stuff I've done in the past. And you end up saying, well, there's been some things that I'm not too proud of. There's a lot of things I am proud of. Maybe there is some kind of bulk of work there that is worth a mention.
You've said you're not a nostalgic person.
No, not at all.
So how does it feel to be forced to look back?
Well, that's what I find interesting. I mean, last week was really, really an interesting week for that because you have to sit down and you have to look at it. Something you shot 15 years ago, and it's really, you're confronted with the ghost of your old ideals, theater is not like that. Theater, even if you tour a show for 5-6 years in a row, the day you perform it is who you are that day. But a film is always something that you've forgotten that you've done, and it comes back and you go, my God, what have I done? Or who was I? Or why did I do that now? So it's very, 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 it's sometimes very jarring at times.
You said something. And our first interview on this show, we've talked a few times, but it was in 2008, and we had a conversation in London, England. And you said something that I have thought about. It stayed with me. It was such an interesting observation. Take a listen to this. This is what you said in 2008.
I don't have a career. It's a plan. You say, I've done this, and this is good for my career. And you hear all these people saying, this is good, this wasn't good for my career. Everything I've done in my life has been good for me. Even the bad stuff or the stuff that's been panned, they're all part of the experience. And you want life to surprise you.
Now, this is you responding to me saying, what do you mean you don't have a career? And you would refuse to characterize it that way.
Absolutely.
You really have no long-term plan.
No, I don't have any long... I mean, there's nothing worse than... things happening to you that you've planned, right? You don't want what you've planned to happen to you. You want something completely that comes from the side to surprise you and make you to bring you on a different path.
You want to be surprised by yourself.
Well, yeah. I want to be surprised by life. I want to be surprised by art and by collaborations and bump into people I never thought would collaborate with me or that I'd get to meet. I think that's more interesting. And there's nothing sadder than things happen the way you had planned them, because we don't have a lot of imagination. We say, in 20 years or 25 years, we want this to happen to us. And of course, our imagination is very limited about the future. In the future, there's a lot of exciting things that should happen to you that you shouldn't know about.
How do you develop the confidence to just follow your muse? I mean, partly people take some... some solace or derive some confidence from having a plan, from knowing, okay, at least for the next year or two, this is my path. This is what I'm going to do. If you throw all of that out and just sort of follow your heart, your passions, your art, How do you have the confidence it's all going to work out okay?
Well, it's just that when you start off, you don't have any confidence and you fall flat on your face all the time. And then suddenly you do something good. And then the same critics or the same people or the same audience that booed you come back to cheer you. You go, well, you know what? You know, a bad review is not forever. A bad choice you made is not forever. And I've done enough bad stuff in my life to be confident that there are among these things, things that are, you know, much better and that you could actually grow out of them. So that's where every time I embark onto a new project, I'm never really nervous. I know something's going to come out of it eventually. But it needs to go through the rite of passage of, you know, being booed, being panned, going on the wrong path, taking the wrong turn. And eventually, certainly in the work of theater where you start all over all the time, you get a chance to make it better. So, you know, there's been some.
But you don't start all over all the time. You're Robert Lepage. So you get to walk into a theater with all kinds of, not just experience, but expectations of others and deference, people who are going to listen to you in a way they wouldn't listen to you when you were 19.
Yeah, but they're not your friends, you know. They're not the ones going to help you grow. And that's what I find interesting. You know, we did a show a long time ago called The Seven Streams of the River Ota.
Yes.
And we had a three-hour version that we premiered at the Edinburgh Festival, and all of the British press was there waiting for the new Lepage show and all of that. And it sucked donkey. It was terrible. It was the worst thing ever. Everything happened to us and all that. And the same people who panned it about a year or a year and a half ago gave us the prize for one of the best 10 productions of the 20th century. So, you know, you could actually go back to the drawing board, take their criticism in, take what the audience thinks in, and, you know, try to give it another shot. And I never let go. I always, when I decide to stop a show or an experience, I decide to do it the day that we feel that we've completed it, that it said what it had to say in the best of manners.
Let me come back to this, because this is this is an interesting process that seems so singularly unique. But let's fill out some of the story first. You take me back to the beginnings of this career, if I can call it that. I know it's a contentious word for you. This is the place where you first encountered your muse. You grew up in Quebec City.
Yep.
Your father was
a taxi
driver, your mother a homemaker. You've talked about being isolated as a young person after you lost all your hair due to alopecia, which must have been a rough thing to go through as a child. Tell me more about that time.
Yeah, well, it was the days of the Beatles, and everybody started to have long hair, so it aggravated the thing even more. But so I mean, you're always kind of pushed aside or made fun of or whatever that. But the thing is that I never kind of go back to that period and complain. I think actually it was a good thing to be isolated, and a lot of very interesting work comes from artists that had a very sad and isolated life when they were young. But then, you know, you grow stronger for that. And eventually, when I was a teenager, I went into a depression for a couple of years, and theater seemed to be a kind of a salvation for me in the high school, because it was the form of art that allowed you to hide behind the group. All other art forms or expressions meant, you know, being courageous enough to confront an audience and speak for yourself. But theater was more of a collective thing. So that way it was easier for me to kind of
You had found your salvation. Did you know at that point you had also found your life work?
No, that I didn't know, because at the same time I was very passionate about geography. And I didn't see how the two could be reconciled. Hmm. And it's only when I auditioned way too early, when I was 17, I auditioned at the conservatory and I was accepted. And
Which conservatory?
Conservatory of Quebec, Conservatory of Theater.
Theater.
In Quebec City. And after these 3 years, I started to tour and I started to do, and I said, okay, that's where geography comes back into the, not only as a theme, but also geography comes back into my life in the form of touring and collaborating with other people from other cultures.
When you were first entering theater and it provided this escape, this home, this salvation, and obviously a passion, have the reasons why you do what you do changed over the years?
I guess they haven't really, because my work is pretty much about, you know, my identity and trying to find who I am. I've never been to any kind of therapy. All my friends have, and I realize because I do theater, basically. And a lot of my work is about trying to understand what makes me tick, why I am the way I am. So it's pretty much the same thing, the same quest of trying to find who I am. And that means sometimes traveling because of we don't know who we are as a people until we've gone somewhere else and compare ourselves to other people, and then we know, okay, I know what it means to be Canadian, I know what it means to be Quebecois, and I think I know what it means to be myself, you know. So, and but you can't do that if you don't go out there and exchange and compare.
I'm curious what it what you delineated those three things. Are they different? What it means to be you, Quebecer, and Canadian?
They're three radically different things. But and that's, I think, one of the big political problems right now in this country is that we're trying to define what the word nation means, what the word culture means. There's a big misunderstanding, I think, between all communities.
Do you identify as a Canadian or as a Quebecer?
I do outside of Canada. See, that's the thing I think there's a kind of a solidarity. If let's say. We don't need to imagine it. It's already like that. On this earth, there's all these conflicts and these tensions and all that. But let's say Martians invaded, we'd all be Earthlings. We'd all go, well, let's band together. And so that's what I mean, is that I don't feel really Canadian when I'm in Quebec. Quebec is its own thing. But then I travel and I bump into Canadians and I feel Canadians. Okay, I know there is such a thing as Canada. Hmm. It's something I can actually, but it's abroad. I don't necessarily feel.
Do you ever feel both things?
I could feel many things.
Like,
at
what
the
are
same
you
time.
In this moment right now?
At this moment, I think I'm both a Canadian and a Quebecois. But it's mainly when I work outside. It's when I'm in France or in England or in Venice. You go, okay, I think I know what it is to be Canadian. This is what it is. Hmm. And I think that people should travel more to understand what it's about.
Where does your quest, your thirst to mm-hmm. innovate come from?
I don't know, actually. I think that I've always been a great fan of the Italian Renaissance artists and people who were, let's say they were called or named artists, but they were more, I'd say, curious people, people who were also interested in science and technology and whatever was around at their times, and would invent forms of art like opera. You know, in 1608, the first opera happens because there's a bunch of crazy people from different disciplines who get together and say, why don't we invent a form of expression that would include architecture, that would include mm-hmm. literature and theater and music. And I've always been an admirer of that, and that is an innovation in itself. And so that's what I think. I don't want to be cornered as just a theater artist. Of course, I'd say that's my forte, but it's not. I'm not just that. I think that.
But do you ever want to just relax and do something that's kind of? I'm going to direct Neil Simon's California
no
Suite.
No way!
Like, does it always have to be about breaking the
no,
ground?
No, but that's not what I'm trying to do either. It's just that I've been offered, let's say, an opera. In opera, I'm being offered the Traviata and the Magic Flute and all that, and I don't do them because I'm not good at that. Let other people who are better at that do it. I'm better when I get the dogs. You know?
You're not good at interpretation.
I'm not good at interpretation, and I'm not good at doing something that somebody does better than me. I like working with tough stuff that hasn't been solved. So when people come up to me and ask me to do Erwartung or stuff like that, I go, oh. And I really work on it, and I find solutions that don't seem to be part of the toolbox that usually comes with the repertoire.
Are you ever scared of your own creativity? Do you ever think that's going too far? I can't. What am I thinking here? Because your thoughts seem relatively boundless based on the, if you think you should do a 9-hour show, you do it.
Yeah, I do it, but that's also because how can I say? I don't have a plan. I never have a plan. So
you've said that.
But I know I don't have a plan in my work. So. But I believe this, things will show up, things will pop up, and solutions will pop up, and so I don't. I'm not afraid to venture. It's always a bit like Christopher Columbus. You're the captain of a ship. There's supposed to be a continent over there. You have to keep people not. You don't want a mutiny, and you want people to. So you have to be convincing. You say, well, we're going somewhere. Where are we going? I don't know, but we're going somewhere. Well, what's the shape of the continent? I don't know, but I know there's a continent. So it's that kind of.
But the voyage doesn't have to be perfect. You alluded to it mm-hmm. earlier. You've opened shows despite mm-hmm. your massive success. Your approach is mm-hmm. fascinating. You've opened shows that were quote unquote under construction,
absolutely,
like they weren't even finished, and they suffered harsh reviews. But mm-hmm. but you say it always arrives where it belongs in the end.
Yeah.
Why would you take an? I mean, this is going to be confusing to some people that you mm-hmm. would take the risk to open up a show that you don't even think is finished. This is the legendary directors of movies and plays that'll keep workshopping it before they open it to get it as perfect as possible, right?
Yeah, well, it depends. I mean, if you're from the literary world, of course, you will write on your novel and you'll have editors and people to console you. And I don't think you'll publish the book until it's publishable. And then if it has a success or not, that's another story. But in theater, it's different. The craft is, it cooks in front of the audience. The craft works when it's in dialogue with the audience. So if you do it and you write it and you devise it without the audience, it's only half-baked. And so, of course, we're in a very efficient world where we want to sell tickets and we want things to have a certain length and be programmed in a certain way. But my work doesn't work that way. And I think that it's much closer to the early works of Shakespeare or Molière, or these people who were writing along the way. You know, they were Shakespeare wasn't writing. He was writing extraordinary poetry and all that. He had a plan. He had a structure. But he was changing the text every day. He was rewriting it according to the audience. It's always evolving.
Is it ever finished?
No, I don't think so. But there's a moment where it feels finished. So you just put it aside, and then 20 years later, an actor says, "I want to do that again." I say, "Well, if we do it,
but you're saying this is the technique Shakespeare had."
Oh, completely.
So to Shakespeare, Midsummer Night's Dream would not be finished right now.
Probably not. And but the proof of that is that the famous all the myth around the text of Shakespeare. You know that they found the text like 26 or 28 years later, that they put together all these prompters, a piece of text, and then another one had a part of his role, and they got all glued that together. And they say, "Well, this is the play." Well, that's not the play. Those are kind of different versions of the play, different pieces of the play glued together by scholars or people who think they know what the play is. But the original thing was much more improvised, much more spontaneous.
But Robert, you've even gone further than this. You've said trial, error, and at times even public humiliation are part of the process of defining one's uniqueness.
Yeah.
Really? Public humiliation?
Oh,
do you
completely.
Feel like you've experienced that?
Oh, totally. All the time.
All
the time, yeah. And but it's counterbalanced by a lot of success or a lot of praise or prizes like the Glenn Gould Prize. There's always something that kind of praises, if it's not your talent, at least your courage. But I don't mind that. I don't mind being panned by people.
How do you not let that bother you?
Well, it did when I was much younger, because you use critics to fortify yourself and to give you the permission to do what you do. But there's a moment where you don't need permission from anybody. And there was a moment in Montreal where I gave a press conference and somebody said, "Okay, these people are going to be here." And I said, "Well, not this guy, not this guy, not this guy." And I said, "Well, you can't do that. That means that you're censoring the..." But I said, "They do that to us. They decide who they interview. Well, why can't we say, well, we don't want to lose time giving an interview to this guy, that guy, that guy?" So it created a huge controversy, and there was a huge boycott of the press. And then after that, you know, nobody wanted to do an interview with me. So, okay, fine. And it was liberating. I thought this would kill me, but actually it was completely liberating. It was a very liberating experience that lasted a couple of years. And after that, I started giving interviews again and all that. But it was people misplace things. We all think that we need the media to be known. Of course, it's an extraordinary tool, the media, but we are the content of the media. The media needs us. So, and nobody dares to challenge that. And this was, and I didn't do this to be provocative or to be, it was just a choice. I don't want to lose time with this guy, that guy, that. I don't have time. I have little time. And but it was, I discovered that actually I didn't really need that. I was at a point where I didn't need anybody's permission to do what I do, and they could continue panning it or disagree with it. That's fine. That's okay. I'm open to the dialogue.
You've been known when you remount shows to take the opportunity to completely remap them.
Yeah.
This comes as no surprise given what we've been talking about. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of the recent remounting of your hit play of 20 years ago, Needles and Opium, right? You said, quote, "My God, I was an idiot 20 years ago." When you're a young artist, I still haven't come out of that phase. You're a young artist, you take such chances, and I got away with murder. It hurts to go back to those days.
Uh-huh.
Why do you go back? Why? I mean, why would you even choose to revamp something at all?
Well, it wasn't my idea. It was the idea of the actor who wanted to do it. And I said, well, if you agree to revamp the whole thing and rewrite the whole thing, I'll do it. And that's what we did. And it's interesting to go back to the past, but at the condition that you could speak these words again or tell that story again with a more mature voice. And, you know, 20-some years went by, and what you think of love when you're 28 and when you're 56 is very different. You have more experience. You have other things to say. You can't pretend you are who you were. So, of course, you have to rewrite. Of course, you have to
repaint.
When
you say... I mean, to a certain extent, you give the impression that so you're not a perfectionist because mm-hmm. you're willing to let things live and breathe
Absolutely.
That even you don't think are perfect and you put them out there. Mm-hmm. And yet, isn't it a form of perfectionism that you keep wanting to retool things to get them to a certain? I mean, you're clearly driven to get it. Mm-hmm. You don't stop with a piece.
No.
I mean, so what is that instinct in you if that's not professional?
Well, I think it's a lot of humility because it means that you know, we're in a world where people need heroes and they need masters, and people say, I know about this, let me do this. And I don't know anything. And I have the humility of saying, well, I don't know what this is about. Mm. Let me work on it. I'm a good pupil. I'm a good learner. So I have the humility of saying, well, I think I haven't gone all the way into this subject matter. So let's let it at rest. And 20 years later, maybe I know a bit more. But it's still not, you know, we should always dig.
Mm.
And I don't mind never finding the ultimate answer to the problem that I'm bringing on stage, but I know more than the last time I did it, that's for sure.
The last time we spoke, you were in the midst of your massive production of Wagner's Ring Cycle mm-hmm. at the Met, the Metropolitan Opera in mm-hmm. New York. You said you were really excited about opera. You said it was the form that felt most vibrant to you and full of possibilities. I'm mm-hmm. curious about what that means for your first love of theater. How are you feeling mm-hmm. about the health and vibrancy of theater right now? Is that something that you worry about?
Yes, I worry about it because I don't think people are doing theater necessarily for the right reasons, or they know exactly what it is. I think theater in this day and age, with all the offers that, you know, there's a lot of out there, Apple TV, Netflix, television in general, films, 3D films, the web, et cetera, et cetera. There's a lot of people who have stories to tell, and there's a lot of offers. So what does theater bring? What does theater has to be to be different, to distinguish itself from all these other offers? And it has to be an event. It has to be a public event. It's a community that meets another community, a community of actors, of artists who have a story to tell, and they're going to say in front of a community that's going to have some kind of impact on the story. That's what the event is about. But in general, theater is produced like a film, or it's produced like TV, or it's produced in a structure or a commercial structure that is not made for it. We should only go to the theater when it's really exciting and an event and worth. There's nothing worse than bad theater. There's nothing worse. I mean, I don't know if you've been to bad theater recently, but you're a hostage. It's the worst feeling in the world.
What is bad theater to you?
Bad theater is when what goes on stage never comes into the room. And bad theater is actors who seem to be having fun on stage, seem to be full of emotion and all the things that we tell actors to do, but there's no emotion in the room.
It's not connecting. Why doesn't it connect? What are the ingredients that make?
Because they're not. Because they have an old idea of what the theater is, or acting is, or theater writing is. In theater schools, it's horrible. Actors are being asked to emote a lot, you know, to find the triggers of emotion. And okay, that's all very fine, but first start by knowing what you're talking about. And I think there's less of that going on in theater. People don't necessarily know what the words mean, but they know what the situation is. They know what the emotion of the character is. So there they are on stage doing all of this stuff, and they seem to understand each other. And very often they almost turn around looking at us saying, sorry, can you not cough? Can you not exist? Because we have this thing to do. So we're never invited into the emotion. And I think that's actors, young actors, are being brought up in this way of thinking, because, of course, they are trained for cinema, right? And cinema is about that. You know, there's no audience in the room when you do it, and the camera will come and detect and get all of the little details that will trigger emotion in the room. But on stage, it's about something else. You have to be seen and heard. Otherwise, nothing. And very often, the fourth wall is so thick. So very often I go there and I go, oh, I don't feel invited. I paid my ticket, I sit there, and I can't share the action.
You're a passive participant.
Absolutely.
Right.
And that's bad theater for me.
Do you have a prescription for how that could change? I mean, really, what is the best way to keep theater relevant as a way mm-hmm. of telling stories to modern audiences then in the Netflix mm-hmm. and Apple TV generation, yeah. right?
Well, as I think that the theater has to be the meeting place of not only the people, not only the audience and the artists, but all the different disciplines. That's why I was doing the praise of opera. I think opera certainly does that. But the idea that the ephemeral, you have to accept that theater is an ephemeral thing, and that the advantage you have when you're an audience member, you sit there and you're looking at something that will never happen again. Even if they're playing the play again tomorrow, it won't be the same thing. It wasn't the same people in the room. Mm. Politically, socially, what's going on around while we are, all of that plays into it. And it would be a long week of workshop to explain exactly what I think good theater is, but as I say, I think a lot of people are using theater right now because they cannot afford publishing a book, or they cannot afford doing cinema, because they're very, very, certainly film or television is very expensive to produce. So people go to theater without knowing exactly what that animal is.
You always seem to be working on many projects at mm-hmm. once. Is there something about that works for you creatively? I mean, or is that out of necessity? Do you get energy from multitasking on various projects?
What it is that you have artists who work, let's say they work on a play, and the play is a planet, right? And they cannot leave that planet for the next 2 years or 3 years until they get it right. I like playing in a cosmos. I like being part of a cosmos. And in a cosmos, you have all sorts of planets, and you have stars, and you have black holes, and you have all these things going on. And you find the answers of a problem very often on another planet. So let's say I'm doing an opera and I bump into a problem. If I'm working on a circus show at the same time, chances are I'll find the solution on the circus show. And you understand at one point that if you do many things at the same time, that you'll find everything informs each other. Mm. And that's more exciting, it's richer. I don't know. I'm more stimulated by that kind of thing, and I don't consider it as multitasking in that sense, because each of these projects have a different purpose.
Do you like chaos?
Yeah, I love chaos, and you cannot have order if you don't have chaos first, right? And it's a very Buddhist way of looking at life. But remember that the lotus is the most beautiful thing in creation, and it comes from the murky, chaotic waters. It's everything comes out of something extremely chaotic.
Does the art that comes out of mm-hmm. is it then outside of the chaos, or can the art be the chaos sometimes?
No, it has to start in chaos, but eventually it kind of raises above it, and something extraordinary comes out without you even trying.
Wow.
And that's what you have to, that's why I feel privileged. I feel at times that I'm not doing much effort. I'm just entertaining the chaos, and I have the pot of mud, and I kind of stir it, and people say it doesn't smell very good. I say, that's okay, let's continue. And eventually something extraordinary comes out of it, and it's beyond your control.
Well, you've just, one of the projects you've just got going was uh-huh. just announced, a one-man show mm-hmm. exploring the theme of memory that you'll be performing as part of Panamania 2015 Arts Festival. This is a month-long a festival held to coincide with the Pan Am Games. You've explored memory in previous work, Robert. Mm-hmm. What's drawing you back to that theme?
Well, because I feel, and certainly being a Quebecer, that memory is an important thing at every level. This show, of course, is about all sorts of kinds of memories. It's about personal memories, and it's about collective memories. It's about short-term versus long-term memory. There's a scientific side to it, how memory works, what is invented memory and all that. So I indulge into all of these things. But what I find interesting is that I come from a province where the license plate says, je me souviens. And je me souviens means I remember.
Yes.
And if you ask any Quebecois, very, very few people know why it's, what does it mean. And so you ask people, and they say, je me souviens. What am I supposed to remember? Why is it that? And people don't know. And you think it's incredible. The people whose motto is I remember, or I will remember, they don't know remember what. So that's why this show is pretty much about the 60s and how people remember that period, because the 60s was a very, very important shift in Quebec culturally, politically, and it happens to be the 10 first years of my life and where a lot of things happened. And so my personal history versus the history of Quebec and what people think it is, and how, for example, in English Canada, the history books are not the same as in French Canada. And all these things are quite interesting for me, you know, and that's memory. That's, and if we don't have the same memory, how can we be a country?
But we don't have the same memory. Well, and no, memory's always changing. Absolutely. And new generations have different memories.
Absolutely.
The history becomes malleable.
Absolutely. And we invent a lot of that, and it's a lot of that memory that never really happened. But it's also a show about theater, because theater is the art of memory, right? The very first thing, very first compliment you get when you're a kid and you play in a show, and your aunt or your uncle comes to see the show and says, you know, oh my God, so you have so much memory. You remembered all your lines. You know, it seems that it's first of all about remembering. So it occurred to me that that's probably the purpose of theater. It's an art of memory. In Catalonia, when Franco, during the Civil War, came and said, well, sorry guys, but the Catalonian language is out, so you speak Spanish from now on, and they burned a lot of books, and suddenly said, yeah, but the actors who played the Catalonian plays, they'll remember, so they shot them. And those who weren't shot went to Madrid and all that. So one day I'm in Barcelona, and in the National Theater of the director of the National Theater of Barcelona offers me to do a Shakespeare, and he says, you know, it'd be nice if you did one of these Shakespeares where there's an old character like Prospero in The Tempest or King Lear, because now we have the actors to perform them. Mm. I said, what are you talking about? You have the actors. You always have the actors. He says, no. Very recently, we started to have a generation of actors in Catalonia who are 72, 75, 80, and it's so suddenly the role of an actor is to remember. And for me, that says a lot about what theater is about.
Where is the line then, though, for the guy who, the self-proclaimed person who's not interested in nostalgia, mm-hmm. between that and returning to the theme of memory? Yeah. What's the difference?
Well, I think that when I go back to the past, I don't go back for nostalgic reasons. I reinvent the past. What I do is autofiction, right? So this is a very tricky show, because actually I'm speaking as Robert Lepage. I don't even play a character I talk about, of course. And half of it is true and half of it is completely false. But if it was all true, it wouldn't be art, right? And so that's what I'm saying. I'm not going there for nostalgic reasons. I'm really going there to try to recreate a certain form of memory of the past.
You've said in previous interviews that you do art, one does art, to know what you're about. Mm-hmm. Where would you say you are right now on that journey of knowing what you're about?
Well, I don't know. It's the...
Why is that funny?
Well, it's funny because I don't know how to answer this, because I think I probably haven't found yet. But I don't know how to answer this, because I think that as I'm aging and advancing and learning about this, I have the impression that even though I've done a lot of stuff, written a lot of stuff, I'm more of a kind of visual sensitive guy, in the sense that I draw things out. I explain them. I do contours and stuff. And in the past couple of years, I've been more and more interested in music and learning music and all that. And I kind of discovered that I've been kind of shying away from that side of me, that inner understanding of things, and that actually I'm probably much more of a private person, and I'm much more an introvert than I thought I was. And so music is slowly kind of pointing in that direction. So I don't know if I'll be abandoning visual arts or visual technology or whatever, but I think I'm slowly moving into the spoken word, into music, into the world of sounds. And I've always thought, anyways, that radio is the most visual of mediums, right?
Wow.
It's a way to enter some...
Theater of the mind.
Absolutely. If you want to create the best images and you really want to enter somebody's, talk radio or speak or put music or whatever. And for me, it's... And that's what I'm discovering with time, that I've been very, very... Not that I didn't already know some of these things, but I've always been very, very superficial about a lot of things and never really dared, give it a chance. And I think that that's pretty much where I'm heading right now, that I know maybe the lights will be off in the theater and there'll just be a lot of voice or whatever. I don't know. I don't know what it is, but I know that that's what I'm drawn to. And it's simplicity, and it's... And it's believing in the power of words more, and it's having more confidence in sound, and of course, it's a much more inner sensitive kind of a process.
Glenn Close was on this show just recently, a few weeks ago, and she said, I'm paraphrasing, something to the order of, I will always be an incomplete person. Uh-huh. You know, does that resonate for you?
Oh, completely. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. And I think that all of these...
So as you get, as you grow, you mm-hmm. don't get any closer to being finished.
No, no. Because I'm always kind of pushed in another direction. So even though you train hard to work on that muscle, there's another sport that's going to interest you. And suddenly that muscle fade away and, you know, force you to develop another muscle.
It's a great pleasure to always speak to you, and it's mind expanding. You push the boundaries in within a conversation that is so much fun. Congratulations on this award.
Thank you.
And I hope that based on the momentum of this award, you'll get better at Guitar Hero, which
you,
I understand.
You heard about that.
I understand is an obsession.
Well, it was an obsession. That's why I bought a piano, because I felt ridiculous. I was actually rehearsing on tour in my hotel room with my plastic guitar, and I went from easy to medium to hard to expert.
Wow.
And when I got expert at Metallica, I felt ridiculous. There was something there that I went, my God, this is, you're pretending you're a guitarist. This is stupid. So I bought a piano, and now I'm learning piano.
I wanted to get that in there because it's a little chink in the armor of the hardworking Robert Lepage. We can take some solace in knowing that you also sit around playing Guitar Hero or that kind of thing.
Who says that Guitar Hero is not hard work?
That's right. Well, yes, and probably part of the artistic process. Thank you for this.
It's a great pleasure.
Great pleasure.